Aloha from Hawaii. Tonight we're going to do practices in Tibetan Buddhist tradition of contemplating the mind's pure nature with practice and learning to meditate using color codes and symbols, numbers, and so forth. And at some point in the class, we're going to do the practice of the Buddha, female Buddha Prajnaparamita with her C syllable and mantra. And all of this is to bring the body, speech, and mind into a state of compassion, power, and insight. Now, those three qualities are lacking in the human condition simply because we're so emotionally involved with everything, what we sense, think, and our relationship. So compassion, power, and insight are instilled through these practices. If one of those is lacking, then there's not much progress. To explain this a little better, if you have insight, that means you have knowledge and know the state of voidness, your true nature, and you have power to use that, but you don't have compassion, that could be very dangerous. That could actually lead to what we call rebirth in the spirit world. Then if you have power with compassion but no insight, you wouldn't know how to apply the compassion. If you have compassion and insight, no power, you wouldn't know how to use the compassion and the insight. So these three must be accomplished together. And the simplicity of this is simply moving out of the head, being heady, attached to everything that we think and believe, and moving into the heart, more and more heart involvement, more and more kindness, and concern for the well-being of others, concern for the well-being of our environment, Mother Earth, and basing that on affection, like the mother for the children, having affection. So the first part of the class tonight is, because we have two natures of mind, we're going to start with the altruistic motivation and connect that to what we call the first level of practice, which is taking refuge. When you're taking refuge, you're actually taking refuge with your own innate true nature that we call Buddha. That's why we're called Buddhists. But this innate true nature is being expressed outside of us in many different ways. And that comes from mostly human teachers, men and women. And so that guidance, that outer support, that outer source of information is actually coming from your, manifesting from your own development of your true nature, which we call insight. So first, before we start the practice, we'll take the refuge. When we say these first words of the refuge, in order to attain enlightenment for ourselves and limitless sentient beings, our mothers, when we say that, we're actually expressing the compassion, power, and insight of this motivation. So we take refuge and offer prostrations. Prostrations are a practice of bringing the body, speech, and mind together into the connection of these three qualities. Then when we say we go for refuge to all the glorious holy lamas, that means we're going to refuge to all the outer support for guidance and how to accomplish the transformation of our body, speech, and mind into these three extraordinary qualities, which I just mentioned was compassion, power, and insight. When we go for refuge to all the idioms, the deities gathered in the mandalas, that means we're using mandala practice of the sutra and tantric tradition of Tibetan Buddhism which is inseparable from the Lama, and the Lama can't teach you this unless they're doing those practices. When you say you go for refuge to all Buddhas, those who have conquered the mind and gone beyond, that simply means a Buddha is a mature human being who no longer is emotionally involved with what they think and do. And that's kind of beyond our concept. When we go for refuge to all the Supreme Dharma, we're talking about the Mahayana Buddhist, Tibetan Buddhist tradition of Tantra and fast-tracking, for instance, accomplishing what we need to do to reach maturity in one lifetime. And that's never been available before, especially in the Western world. Eastern world, they had some, but Western world, never before. We go for refuge to all the noble sangha. The word noble implies lamas, teachers of sutra and tantric tradition, and with a lineage from Shakyamuni Buddha 2100 years ago down to the present day. And when we go for refuge to all dhakas and dakinis, these are the protective aspects that arise from our involvement with the Dharma, which are already in place in the Lama's practice. So in a definition of Tibetan Buddhism, it's called shamanistic Lamaism. And you should know it's not a religion. Most Buddhists practice Buddhism as a religion. Tibetan Buddhism is simply a healing program for the good health of your body, the good health of your mental capabilities, the good health, by bringing these emotions into some form of discipline or use, and by accomplishing a spiritual connection to the already established beings in our world, which are animals, humans, and spirit. That's where we get the word spirituality. But I think spirituality is better defined as shamanism, because we use the spirits for healing. Normally, they're an obstacle. So now we're going to say this all together. In order to attain enlightenment for ourselves and limitless sentient beings, our mothers, we now all together take refuge and offer prostration. We go for refuge to all the glorious holy lamas. We go for refuge to the or the deities gathered in our mandalas. We go for refuge to all the Buddhas, those who have conquered the mind and gone beyond. We go for refuge to all the Supreme Dharma. We go for refuge to all the Noble Sangha. We go for refuge to all Dakas and Dakinis, who are the protectors and defenders of the Dharma. All of these possess the eye of transcending awareness. Then we chant this in Sanskrit, and I'll chant the first prayer, the one that says, in order to train enlightenment for ourselves and limited sentient beings, our mothers, we now all together take refuge and offer prostration. In Sanskrit, that goes like this. Dog dong dro wa nam ke da dong yam ke sam chen tam che du di ne tun che. Tunche Ningpo La Chi Ki Bardu. And we chant. All then Lama Dhamma Nama Jam Su Chi Yo Ye Dan Cho Por Gi La Cho Nam La Jam Su Chi Yo Sanje Chom Den De Nam La Jam Su Chi Yo Dampe Chu Nam La Jap Su Chi Yo Pao Pe Gendum Nam La Jap Su Chi Yo Pao Wo Kandro Cho Kyun Sum Me Cho Ye Che Ski Shen Dong Yen Pa Nam La Jap Su Chi Yo Nam La Jap Su Chi Yo. We all together are performing these practices. Whatever practice we do, you think, everybody in the entire universe is doing it with you. That takes away the idea of separation right away. Here, take this. The second prayer is to bring the method together with this motivation and the support of the six refuges. It says to the Buddha Dharma and this Supreme Assembly. The Supreme Assembly is referring to the refuge of the six that we just took refuge in, which are the Buddha Dharma and Sangha, which are called the three jewels, and the Lama, the deity, and the protectors, which are called the three roots of Tantra. We go for refuge until enlightenment using that support together with what we call six disciplines of the Bodhisattva path, which says, may I, through merit gained from practicing these six perfections, accomplish Buddhahood for the sake of all beings. Now, right away, you're expressing that you're not doing this for yourself. You're doing this for all sentient beings. But if you understand there's no such thing as separation, then of course you're included. But we try to keep the I out of it, because the I is problematic. We want to change the I to we. And that helps us to more and more accept the fact that everything is interconnected. To the Buddha Dharma and this Supreme Assembly, we go for refuge until enlightenment. May I, through merit gained from practicing the six disciplines, accomplish Buddhahood for the sake of all beings. Sangye cho dang cho ti cho nam ma jen cho bargu yani chab su chi yagi jen so ji pe so nam ti cho la ten jer sangye cho bargu. That word group, where it says very last, group par show, group is practice. It is actually the most important word in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, and especially in the lineage of the Kagyu Lama. We're called the practice lineage because we stress that with all the methods and all the motivation that we take refuge in, without practicing, nothing is accomplished. And I'm not talking about reading about it or seeing it or hearing it or receiving blessings from high teachers like the Dalai Lama. I'm talking about actually taking this and working it with your body, speech, and mind, and gradually moving more and more out of the headiness of thought and emotional involvement into a more relaxed position of compassion, you know. Just have it all go outward, like the sun's radiance. Compassion in our lineage is called altruism. We do that because we impartially apply this concern for the well-being even to the worst of the humans and the worst of the animals in the ocean and on the land and the nastiest, most psychotic spirit. We're including them, see. Usually other traditions, religions which I've practiced before either don't acknowledge or absolutely exclude certain animals, certain classes of humans, and definitely the lower realms of the spirits. Now, most religions really like the high realms of the spirits. They like the gods and goddesses, you know. They call them creators, divine, supreme, supernatural. They give them status and they adore them. But that's pretty tricky because they don't understand the condition of these gods and goddesses. That they have the best of everything. Now, if you want to understand having the best of everything, you could kind of think about America and who, like 1% of the wealth is a very, very small percent of the people owns 99% of the wealth. Are they sharing it? No. But like that, the heavenly spirits, you know, they want to keep this all to themselves. They're very proud and arrogant about their accomplishment. And you must have compassion for them, because just like here in the human realm, everything is impermanent. Well, it is also in the celestial realm. They don't believe that until they get into the situation where it slowly starts to deteriorate. Then they start to get a clue, but then that causes suffering for them. Then there's another category of spirits called war gods and goddesses. Now, we give them a nice classification. I think this comes from the Greek and Latin rulers, but it's called demigods. But these war and war gods, they operate out of coveting and jealousy. They operate that war is a way to attain what they need, not understanding that it's extremely bad karma, not just for them, but for all the people that they're warring over. See? So the war and war gods, they have the very best of everything, as they do in our military. You can see our military is very well taken care of. And they come back without their limbs and everything, and they're honored. You know, they're put in hospitals and everything. So you should understand that these celestial realms that are religiously, I'd say supported by us humans, are not at all desirable. But we include them in our practice because they originated in our world. And I say our world, in this human condition. They came from here. And they have very long lives. Their spiritual world is not like ours. It's impermanent, but not to the degree of this material temporal world. And so we have this compassion of altruistically extending the results of our practice to those beings. And then I said the worst of the spirit worlds, well, that gets down into the psychotic spirit. I mean, they're 100% angry, full of hate and so forth. And they aim mad at us. They can see into our world. We can't see into their world. And then we have the deprived spirits. They're like ex-CEOs of large corporations. We call them deprived spirits. They never get enough. See? We have to have compassion for them. Never being satisfied. That must be really weird. I mean, I'm easily satisfied, but maybe that's because I practice. But in any case, four categories of spirits, and all the animals and humans included in this compassion. Development of power and insight is very important to go with this compassion. Now tonight we're going to contemplate what we call the true nature of our consciousness, which is not apparent, but you can connect to it. Now there's two ways of connecting to your pure nature, which is not judgmental. It's the best way to put it. Most of the sutra and tantra is about actually practicing methods to, I say, transform or connect to this true nature with the actual emotion. But the other way of doing this is go past the emotions and past the thinking into a place of clear light, where those conceptual aspects of your consciousness don't exist. But they come from this natural state of your consciousness. They just got distorted because of your habit of being emotional, which that's been going on for many lifetimes. So I'm going to read a little bit from a book about how to contemplate the nature of perfect clarity, which is a description of your true nature. There are many descriptions. None of them will actually cause you to experience them, but at least it's good to point it out. It says, in this true nature of your consciousness, don't stray from the fresh, natural mind, which is defined as non-judgmental. You simply sit in a relaxed position to avoid fixating on the concepts of good and bad, about what your body is sensing and about what your consciousness is producing as thoughts. So the first practice is to sit with the back straight, eyes open, soften your gaze to the space and light as an energy form of mind directly in front of you. Hands in a comfortable position, either on your knees or in your laps, mouth closed, and the head slightly tilted forward. Then just simply bring your consciousness to this present moment. In other words, don't fixate on what's gone before, past, and don't jump to future events. And when these two things happen, just gently bring your mind back to the present. That's the practice. And this is called contemplating non-judgmental mind. And the judgment that we want to contemplate is this habit of everything either being good or bad. We just watch in the present. Thoughts arise. Don't judge, don't connect. This practice of developing presence is simply to help you to be mindful of this judgmental process that is a habit. When you're doing these contemplation practices, keep the sessions short. It's not about what we call shine, developing peace and tranquility. That's more based on using symbols. Support. Now we're practicing with no support. Just allowing the mind to flow and observing this judgmental method we call habit of whatever arising is good or bad. To go with good and bad, you also have accepting and rejecting. But these two, good and bad, accepting and rejecting, are applied to what we are sensually perceiving, and then to what we are thinking, in connection to what we are sensing. When you understand this process, then it's easier in the meditation practices to remove the habit of judging things good or bad. Why would you want to do that? Is because when you judge something good, you immediately stir your emotions to attach to it. So attachment arises. And this emotional attachment causes you to distort whatever you're sensing or thinking about. That's the problem with any emotion. And to explain why you would want to slowly adjust to judging things bad, is the opposite emotion arises, which is called aversion. Now, these two emotions are simply arising from the thought process of this judgmental good or bad. Understanding that helps you to slowly remove that habit or compensate in some way. If you do that, this process is called the self-cognizant mind in a state developing natural awareness. Now, those are big words. But self-cognizing means self-recognition. Awareness is what you're already using with everything that you're involved with in this drama world. But by being in a state of contemplation, using the present as the motivation, causes the distortion to not only disappear from what you are sensing and thinking about, but you get more and more used to being in a relaxed state of awareness where those two don't exist. The next part of the practice is to know that what you are recollecting or noticing is called mindfulness. It's simply a state of self-awareness contemplating what is called insight. Now, insight is the sixth discipline of the Bodhisattva path. It's called wisdom. Insight means knowing a nature of your consciousness that doesn't cause you pain or suffering. That's the perk of this. It removes this judgmental result of pain and suffering. All of the different Dharma systems taught by the Lamas agree that this is alone or sufficient to do as a regular practice. So we're going to think now about presence itself, being present. To explain that simply means whatever has gone before doesn't exist. That's the path. Whatever is going to happen in the future doesn't exist in the present. And whatever you're experiencing in the present, by the time it gets to your brain, is in the past. So you want to refine the present to a microcosmic, I would say, thousandth of a second. But that takes practice. So just attain presence by being present. Keep your mind here. There's no support for this. Now I'm going to use the bell as an example of these pointing out instruction. So the words are the sound of the bell. Hearing them and practicing them is where the sound goes. And keeping this in context with this particular Lama's pointing out instruction, she says, no matter what kind of seemingly more superior meditation state you might achieve or hear about, such as attaining a state of stillness or bliss, clarity, or non-thought, these are simply nothing but fabrications created by the mind to distract you. Since this cannot be put into words, this uncreated, unfabricated, natural mind is not a flawless meditation. But you must gain a positive certainty about this point. My advice is practice so that you understand this. So we sit with the body in these five positions. Eyes open, mouth closed, hands comfortable, head tilted, back straight. And develop presence, connecting to the clear, natural state of awareness. when one understands the view and what is meant by meditating, these two are inseparable in practice. View and meditation together can be explained in many ways, but the simplest is simply by sustaining the essence of your mind, which means its nature as light, includes them all. Your mind won't be found elsewhere. It is simply your present thought. In the practice of contemplation, you don't fixate and you don't judge. The present process of thought. But you should know that it comes from space, arises as an object, its essence is light, and it will disappear on its own. The thoughts or thoughts as they arise in this state of contemplation, the practices don't chase them, don't attach to them. Just look into their essence, and in that state there is no duality of subject and object. By noticing this lack of separation, one enters into the state of unity. In which everything is interconnected in the present. so that one can understand this intellectually, but without concept. You know the state of light arising as empty, simply because it's not concrete substance. But also it is cognizant. That means it exists in a state of awareness by itself. These two together are not separate. They are simply a unity of the natural state that all beings possess. Even though it may seem like nothing whatsoever, in it, everything is experienced. The practice is to simply recognize this. By establishing this contemplating method as mindfulness without support, you start to sustain this recognition or recognition as cultivating nothing but this as a state of awareness. In this way, it becomes more and more apparent that this is useful in your ordinary, everyday activities. Learning to remain naturally in this state of awareness can be applied to everything you say, think, and do. Don't spoil it by tampering and worrying about it being right or wrong, or good or bad. This ultimate luminosity called the Dharmakaya is simply the unfabricated, natural, pure state of awareness itself. And the final explanation to aware, to attach to this session of contemplation is given by the Lama Jamkin Kantro Rinpoche, and it says, he says, There are many Dharma words in the term Mahamudra and in the development of Dzogchen, the mind of bliss. But the root practice which we just performed is included. If you search elsewhere for something better, for instance, a Buddha superior to this, you are simply chained by hope and fear, so give up any idea of that. Please don't be religious. Devotion and gathering the accumulations are the most important methods of Dharma practice. For completely realizing this teaching, always concentrate on devotion to your Lama Guru, who is the teacher of the Dharmakaya, the all-pervasive nature of one's consciousness. And in this way, your devotion comes to fruit by your applying it to body, speech, and mind. And this is most virtuous. Om. Om. Great. That was almost an hour. It does become apparent that in the practice of meditation and contemplation, as we perform this, that time becomes distorted. And in some cases actually disappears. And we start to experience moments or periods of timelessness. This happens because timelessness itself is beyond concept. And the contemplation methods are about that state of awareness, which is beyond the conceptual processing mind that's so emotionally involved and preoccupied with everything that the body senses and everything that's going on. Everything. But we do these practices, it's called contemplation practices, pointing out the perfection of awareness because it is so useful and requires very little effort in comparison to the meditation practices. And you will see that with what we are about to do is meditation. Since meditation requires support and effort, the simplest form of practice is to bring it into your present situation with something that you are spontaneously doing all the time, which keeps you alive, but requires no effort. Breathing. So the breath, being a source of this life support energy system, is amplified by these practices, not only to bring one into a state of more mindfulness, but health in the body. Being mindful of what you're doing actually creates an energy system that's called chi or prana. And being mindful of your breathing actually changes the ordinary state of breathing in relation not only to your body, but to your awareness, to your consciousness. So all of the lamas of Tibetan Buddhism, and before Tibetan Buddhism became Tibetan Buddhism, use the chi practice of the three lights and attach these three lights to the simple process of the inhale the middle breath of absorbing the energy, and the exhale of sharing the result with others. But we have a more profound expression or understanding of these three breaths in relation to the body, the speech, and the mind's process of becoming mature. So when you inhale the white light energy, which is the life force of the elements of the universe, all together in that air that you're breathing, you're actually bringing in the essence of insight, which we just did in the contemplation practice by noticing that the essence of what was arising, the thoughts, was light, and where they came from was space. And where they go, we don't know. Maybe back to space. So the first inhale of the white light is actually instilling awareness into your body. Then energy produces power. So the second breath of the red light absorption breath of this energy being visualized as blazing through your body in a flash of red light is bringing more power into your situation. And since it's in the body's process of breathing, what you are going to exhale is the result of the insight and the power as an energy program for healing yourself and others. And that's the blue light you exhale to space. So in reality, what you are doing with your body, your speech, and your mind is transforming them into insight, power, and compassion, which is a state of maturity called Buddha. So sit with your back straight. Eyes in front, mouth closed, head tilted, hands comfortable. Eyes is an energy program coming in from the space and light directly in front, which is everything. Bring your awareness to your breathing. Inhaling the air, you visualize it as white light filling your lungs. The absorption breath passes the energy through the body. This produces the power and the insight together so that the exhale is available as a healing remedy for the beings that inhabit space, which is us. Simply inhale the white light, visualize it filling the lungs, the diaphragm expands, everything contracts, the energy is absorbed, the exhales the blue light to space. White, red, blue. Insight, power, compassion. and to increase your discipline or keeping your presence with this practice, count 10 of these three light breaths. Inhale, absorption, and exhale are one count. When you get to the 10th count, then add the three sounds of the Sanskrit states of awareness of compassion, power, and insight. Only we're taking them in as insight, power, and compassion, white, red, blue. With the white inhale of the insight, hear the sound OM. With the energy program processed through the body, which will affect the exhale, hear the sound AH. And then the exhale itself, the sound of healing, the blue light expressed to space, exhaled to space, boom. Inhale, OM. Absorption breath, AH. Exhale, boom. Now, as you get used to doing this practice, this method of the three lights with the three sounds, OM, AH, and BOOM, with the breath, it's good to know that these three lights came from the first practice that we did tonight, establishing the natural mind as non-judgmental. A state of naturally relaxed awareness without connection to drama. But also you should know that it is the body, speech, and mind of all of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, men and women, past, present, and future, that do this practice. The energy and power has no limit. The compassion is applied impartially. And the insight carries the knowledge of its usefulness. Learn to do this practice formally and post-meditationally with whatever you're involved with in the drama field. And at the end of your practice session, bring the three lights and the three breaths all together in union as a particle of light in the center of your heart chakra, right in the middle of your chest, right in the central channel of your life force. And holding your view there, relax into a state of the contemplation of space without a center or boundary. Whatever arises as a sensual product of the body or a habitual tendency of the mind is the same nature. Break. No, it's cracking. Stretch, walk around. When we apply these three sounds in Sanskrit, this is what they look like. And these three sounds are applied to every aspect of the sutra and tantra tradition as taught by the lamas of Tibetan Buddhism. All of the 1,000 deities of the five Buddha families are marked in the head, throat, and forehead, or heart chakra, with these three Sanskrit seed syllables. This is the Om, this is the Ah, and this is the Hum. Now the Hum artistically expressed in thousands of different ways. This is one of the ways I saw it on the web. And it's on a 1,000-petal lotus in space in a starry sky, which is a very good example of the symbolic representation of what we are doing with the exhale. But this is simply applied to the limitless space as being inhabited by limitless sentient beings in need of medicinal remedies. So the Hum is useful in our practice as one of the five Buddha families. And it is this Buddha, which we call Akshobhaya, which is the name of that Buddha family, but it's a Vajra family. And when we use the Vajra family, we are locating a sphere of blue energy in relation to our body, which is mostly a water element, as the entire unlimited aspect of space itself, but inhabited with sentient beings. So this Hum is symbolizing kind of what water does to create like ice or clouds or lakes and oceans and so forth, is it condenses. It comes together, the molecular structure, but it's still water, either as ice, lakes, or clouds. So this condensation collection is the symbol of unity for the sound Hum. But the Hum has this, to be an antidote to the aversion. In other words, when you say, oh, that's bad, which is what religions do. Bad symbolizes aversion. It just, as soon as you say that's bad, that emotion arises. Just a habit. But is it bad? Well, maybe it is for one person, but not another. You got to be careful when you make judgments, because your judgment call may not be shared by other sentient beings in your immediate vicinity. That's another distortion of the problem of these emotional tendencies. But anger and aggression is what arises out of this so-called simple judgment call of bad. So we take this into the energy field of what is called the Vajra family, which means using light and space as a total integration of everything's essence. And then when we meditate, we apply it to the thoughts and the central perceptions of the body. When we contemplate, we apply it to the timeless present that we are connecting to in states of contemplation, which are called voidness. But voidness isn't really nothing, because when you experience voidness and you have feelings of bliss, for instance. Why do you have bliss? Because there's no drama. That's very blissful. You know? And that applies to all drama. Or you have experiences of voidness, which means since you've shifted your awareness to the spatial quality, your thoughts aren't apparent. You don't see the thoughts, even though they're there. And then to the drama field itself, you're clear of the emotional distortion. And that's called clarity. But the problem with those three arising from our practices is because we're humans and have this judgment mind, we tend to attach to that state of bliss or that experience of clarity or the aspect of no thought, voidness. We attach to that. Wow, that's really great. That's so powerful. Okay, when you attach to that, then you're creating another conceptual egocentric state. Even though you use it with the kindness and the compassion and all these good qualities in the mother, you're still fixating on something that doesn't exist. And that's what leads to celestial rebirth, or can lead to celestial rebirth, if you have good karma. So I'm explaining this home. When we use it medicinally, we're now going to do the practice of the bringing the Om Ah Hum together with the female aspect of the Dharmakaya, the all-pervasive nature of mind, as a mature human being, a Buddha, and we're going to locate this directly in front, inseparable from our root Lama. And when we connect to this holographic image in front, which we're imagining, which there's a picture of it, you can show it to the zoomers. This is called PRAJNAPARAMITA, the perfection of wisdom or insight. She has four arms like Chenrei Z. In fact, Chenrei Ji is to be considered to be her consort. Now show the back. Turn it around. On the back of this tanka, which is what they call this symbolic representation in Tibetan, are these three sounds, Om, Ha, and Hum. And so these three are the password.
Thank you.
To bring that artistic representation of the Buddha Prajnaparamita and everything that it symbolically represents as qualities into you. The link is her seed salvo and you adopting that hologram in place of your body. That's it. And because it's a Buddha image, which is, Buddha means all pervasive, you don't have to do what we do with the Tara and Chenrei Ji and Tara, or we call the Bodhisattva deity practice. You don't have to project it to mom and all beings. Because it's all pervasive already, which is what is symbolic of the light coming out of an empty mirror or moon behind her. So she actually is a representation of space, and her sound is Gong. And it looks like this. So the password connecting the deity to you with your body, speech, and mind, power, insight, and compassion. How do we say? Insight, power, and compassion, is to bring all these three to the heart center to this sound, Vam, looks like this. And this is the sound, Sanskrit word for space. But it is also the Sanskrit word for insight. And this is a female energy program, so this is the mother person, principle personified throughout the universe and applied to every sentient being. We sit with our back straight, eyes, space and light in front, mouth closed, tongue resting against the palate so the energy is circulating through this central channel. Hands in a comfortable position, head slightly tilted, lining up the energy centers within the body. And bring your focus to your breathing. Three lights, three sounds applied to the breath. Then take your focus off the breathing and establish in front of you in 3D, three-dimensional holographic form, the female Buddha of maturity, Prajnaparamita. We say, the Buddha of perfect wisdom, awareness of awareness. She is scantily dressed in 5 silks, representing the 5 elements. She has a 5 jewel crown, representing the 5 Dhyana Buddha families. The right hand holds a vajra, or a mala, to symbolize the tantric approach. To maturity, the direct path. The left hand, a lotus with the sutra text of the Heart Sutra. The indirect approach to maturity. And the other 2 hands in the lap, right on top of left thumbs touching, in meditation posture for what we are doing tonight, developing awareness and using meditation with focus and the imagination. And then because we set up the body's format with these 3 lights, with the 3 sounds, the inhale of the white light causes the Om sound to appear in her head and the energy of that penetrating into your head. With the absorption breath of the Ah and the red light, it causes red light to emanate from the Ah in her throat into your throat. And then with the exhale of the blue Hom energy to space, causes the Hom energy in her heart to penetrate with blue light to your heart chakra. When you can see these 3 lights shining simultaneously from the representation of the Buddha Prajnaparamita in front into you, then you merge that image into your body. And with this state of unity, the 3 lights now appear within your central channel of your life force. white om sphere in your head, the red ah sphere in your throat, and the blue om sphere in your heart chakra. Then we energize that with the power of the exhale, focusing on the white om in the head. We chant om. Om. Shift your focus awareness to your throat chakra, to the red ah sphere. Chant ah. Then the blue om sphere in your heart chakra, chant om. Having communicated the password om on om, bring the three into union in your heart center by focusing on the white om sphere coming down the central channel into the red ah sphere. Those two in union move down the central channel into the blue om. The blue om sphere condenses to a particle representing the totality of space. For a few moments, rest, just relax in that awareness of the energy of the universe as all pervasive, symbolized by that particle. Then bring your focus again to the particle and expand it to a tiny sphere or bubble of clear light. This signifies entering into this dimension, our three-dimensional world. Expand the tiny sphere of clear light to a five-color sphere, and in it put the sound of the creation symbol of Prajnaparamita's mandala as space itself, Vam. So that the energy of this practice penetrates boundless space into the heart mind of infinite sentient beings, filling space. Chant Vam. Visualize it in your heart center. Inhale. Vam. And think, all beings that took refuge with you tonight, all your mother sentient beings, animals, humans, and spirits, are now entering into this practice as Prajnaparamita. That causes the heart mantra to appear, and these letters are circling the Vam inside a five-colored sphere of light in your heart chakra. We start with the Tadyata in front and go clockwise, and all the letters are facing inward and they're stationary. Tadyata, Om, Gati, Gati, Para, Gati, Parasam, Gati, Bodhi, Soha. Tadyata, Om, Gati, Gati, Para, Gati, Para. Gate Udi Soha Tadyata Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Udi Soha. Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Parinata Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha The meditation of this symbol of the Dharmakaya of the all-pervasive nature of awareness as perfect, impartially applied limitlessly to limitless sentient being. All of the qualities of the Buddha, which are 32 major qualities and 80 minor qualities, are represented in this symbol. But your practice is simply to focus on the Vam as either red or white in your heart center, with the sound of the mantra as syllables surrounding it, clockwise facing inward, and energy from the Vam and those symbols filling your visualized Buddha form, and then emanating outward as healing energy to all beings in space. And you do this seat syllable, mantra, deity, and the healing energy in the same way that you did your breath. So, inhale, it all comes together. Exhale, it all goes out with the sound of your voice. Tadyata Om Gati Gati Bara Gati Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Bara Gati Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Bara Gati Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Bara Gati Parasam Gati Bodhi Soha Tadyata Om Gati Gati Bara Gati Buddha means mature. Buddha means mature as a human. The full function of motherhood, the full purpose of motherhood, applied to the children. All sentient beings must reach maturity. This practice symbolizes that they are already in that state of awareness. So as a collective, it's infinitely applied, impartially. But as a healing energy, it can be localized to an individual or a group as part of this collective state of unity. So you can visualize that person, living or deceased, as this symbol, doing exactly what you're doing. But it is that person combined with the totality of living beings throughout the universe. Or group, you could apply it to a group that's in dire need of healing. And without the word, The energy of your heart pervading your body is this symbol, Prajnaparamita, pervading space, all realms of sentient beings. All the planets in the universe where there's animals and humans taking birth. All of space from the center of this planet and your body, pervading space, all of the four categories of spirits. All Prajnaparamita in a state of perfect wisdom awareness.
Kante,
Kante, Kante,
Kante,
Kante, Parasangate Kante 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 We are communicating this to the spirits pervading our body and their energy fields around us, and then throughout space to all sentient beings. Kante is beyond concept of the body. The second Kante is beyond the concept of speech. The third Parakate is beyond the concept of mind itself. Parasamgate Bodhisoha means into the pure state of awareness that is timeless, but at the same time applied as healing energy to all living beings as their natural mind in union with the natural world. And soha means this timeless application applied to everyone, always increasing. Tadyata, Om, Kate, Kate, Para, Kate, Parasam, Kate, Bodhi, soha. Tadyata, Om, Kate, Kate, Para, Kate. Arsam gate bodhi soha. Tadyata om gate gate para gate arsam gate bodhi soha. Tadyata om gate gate para gate arsam gate bodhi soha. Tadyata om gate gate para gate arsam gate bodhi soha. Tadyata om gate gate para gate arsam gate bodhi soha. Tadyata om gate gate para gate arsam gate bodhi soha. Then from the Vam in the heart of Prajnaparamita, emanating up the central channel and out her right eye, all the beings of space are imaged as the five classes of Tara, imaging the five colors of the five classes of Tara as the five elements. So now you visualize you as the central figure and all of space pervaded with these five colors of Tara. Tadyatha, Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha, Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha, Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. All the blue-black Taras go everywhere, all the green Taras everywhere, all the white Taras everywhere, all the, we call it the red Taras everywhere, and all the gold Taras everywhere. And their elemental natures bring into harmony all beings' bodies into perfect union with good health. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Then from the Vam and the heart chakra of Prajnaparamita up the central channel and out the left eye, all of the Chenrezis of the five families displayed in five colors, these rainbow energies of method and wisdom filling space, pervading all the realms of existence, animal, human, and spirit. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. All the blue Chenrezis is a state of union. All of the green Chenrezis is a state of karmic action, bodhisattva. All of the white Chenrezis is the clear nature of mind expressed as peace, tranquility, and insight together. All of the gold Chenrezis pervading faith, pervading good health and wealth. And finally, all the red Chenrezis pervading space, discerning what is appropriate, what is not. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Tadyatha Om Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhisoha. Then collect all the Taras and Chenrezis back into your symbol as Prajnaparamita, this Buddha image. All pervasive. The natural mind of human beings. And dissolve the symbol of the Prajnaparamita into the heart mantra Tadyata, Om, Kati, Kati, Para, Kati, Parasam, Kati, Bodhi, Soha. And starting with the words Tadyata, Om, all of that, syllable by syllable, into the space sound, Vam. And that in a five-colored sphere of light, merge with space. Form is awareness. Awareness is form. Taking refuge in performing practices, contemplation, meditation. The virtuous activity is so powerful that part of our practice is to dedicate it as merit. The results of our virtuous activity shared equally among infinite sentient beings filling space. The dedication prayer I'm going to read was written by Kala Rinpoche. It's called the The Eight Thoughts of a Great Being. as a dedication prayer. By the power of the truth of the great compassion of this excellent object of refuge, the three jewels and the three fruit, and by the power of this merit of pure altruism, may I completely remove every misery of all living beings who fill the sky. By the perfect virtues of this world and of Nirvana, may the hopes and desires of all beings be fulfilled according to their wishes. May my own body, flesh, blood, skin, and so forth appropriately benefit all beings. May the miseries of all my old mothers, all living beings filling space, come upon me. May all my happiness and virtue be realized by them. For as long as I remain in this world, may there never arise for even an instant the thought of harming others or my environment. For the sake of living beings, may I energetically exert myself, not slacking for even an instant, through discouragement, weariness, or other causes. May I gain the ability to effortlessly bestow whatever is desired by beings who are poor, who are hungry, or thirsty. May I take upon myself the great burdens of beings who suffer the unbearable torments of the hells and other miserable realms. May all those beings attain liberation right now in this place. Ewa di nirdu da, chagya chempo du dene, joa chinking mahu pa, dei sala so far so, chanje kusu nimpai jumadam, choni nager nimpai jumadam, yendu miche nimpai jumaki, Ketar Goma Momam Juparsho. By this virtue, having realized Mama Mudra, may it quickly establish all beings without a single exception in this state. Through the blessing of the Buddhas who obtained the three bodies, through the blessing of the unchanging truth of this Dharma, and through the blessing of the unwavering aspiration to bless the Sangha, may this and all dedication perish. I'd like to dedicate the merit to Kat, our Dharma student who's having, may she have successful surgery tomorrow. And may she be totally healthy. That goes to her and all beings in union. May all the Lamas have long life, good health, happiness, and prosperity. And may all their wishes be fulfilled. In this world, may all beings have happiness, be free of suffering, be established in bliss by our practice, and may we all become emotionally stable. Duchi chai. Thank you. Mahalo.